Father, we thank you. Father, we bless your holy name tonight. We magnify, we uplift up high your name, O God, and say that, Father, you deserve all the praise and you deserve all the glory, O God. We say thank you, Lord Jesus, for watching over us, O God, and our Savior, and bringing us together once again, Lord Jesus, even to hear your word. We thank you for this wonderful opportunity, O God. It is my prayer that, Lord Jesus, you grant us understanding of your word, O God. It is my prayer tonight that you prevent the enemy from stealing your word, O God, and our Savior, from us. It is my prayer tonight that, Lord, you will prepare our hearts that it shall be a fertile ground, Lord, to receive your word. That, Father, Lord, our lives will never remain the same, O God. Now, Lord, all glory and adoration, my God, shall be unto you. I avail myself, O Lord Jesus, an empty vessel unto you, O God. But Father, you speak through me, O Lord Jesus, tonight. For I have nothing to give, O God. But I know, Lord Jesus, as an empty vessel, that you will speak through me. The Lord, all glory and honor, Lord Jesus, shall be unto you. We thank you, Holy Spirit, and I bless your holy name. In Jesus' mighty name I pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Now tonight, by the grace of God, I would like to share with you the word that I've entitled, The Old Must Die. The Old Must Die. The Old Must Die. Now, a lot of us as children of God, the moment we lifted up our hands and surrendered ourselves or surrendered our lives into the hands of God, we thought that is the end. Oh, as for me, I have surrendered my life unto the Lord. I have accepted him as my God and my personal Savior. Therefore, as for me, heaven, I am bound to go to heaven. I am bound to go to heaven. There's a scripture that we always hear about Nicodemus. Said Nicodemus went to Jesus Christ and asked him, how can I enter into the kingdom of God? And God gave him an answer, which we all know. But tonight, I want us to have a look at that scripture once again and critically assess that scripture and compare it with other scriptures and see what our Lord Jesus Christ meant when he said to Nicodemus, you need to be born again. You need to be born again. I want us to open our Bibles to the book of John, chapter 3. John chapter 3. We'll read from the verse 1. John chapter 3. We'll read from the verse 1. It says, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. Jesus answered and said to him, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. The Lord said to Nicodemus, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Then Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. He said, what? That which is born of the flesh is flesh. And that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Therefore, what the Bible is trying to make us understand about being born again is that when you are born of the spirit, you no more belong to the flesh. He said, that which is born of the flesh belongs to the flesh. And that which is born of the spirit is of the spirit. That which is born of the spirit is spirit. Therefore, if you are born again, you must be what? You must be a person of the spirit, not of the flesh. That is why the old must die. Sometimes we say to ourselves, or we just say by words of mouth, as for me, I am born again. As for me, I am born of water and I am born of the spirit, even as the word of God requires of me. But one thing or one question we need to be asking ourselves tonight is, are we truly born of the spirit? Are we truly born of the spirit? Are we truly born again? The reason the Bible asks us to be born again is to be able to what? Crucify the flesh. It's to be able what? To forget about the things, or to kill or to destroy the flesh and live according to the spirit. Salvation is not a one-time thing that we should do. That is why the Bible encourages us to work on our salvation with fear and trembling. It is not a one-day thing. It is an everyday thing that as children of God, we must be doing. Salvation is not the day. It's not. It has not got to do with only the day that you lifted up your hands and surrendered yourself unto the Lord. Salvation has got to do with every single day of your life. Salvation has got to do with every decision that you make in life. Salvation has got to do with every step that you take in life. That is why the Bible says we acknowledge God in everything that we do, that He will direct your path. Once you have been born by the Spirit, you must live by the Spirit. You must be directed by the Spirit. Your decisions must be controlled by the Spirit. Your conclusions must be drawn by the Spirit. Everything that you do must be dependent on the Spirit. You must ask God for direction. It is a race, as Paul said, that we are in. We must run that we can be able to take the crown. So it is a race. A race has a beginning and the end. The beginning is when you lifted up your hands and surrendered your life into the hands of the living God. And the end is when your God calls you unto Himself. And that is where a decision is made. Whether you enter into the kingdom of God or you don't. And this is why you need to work on your salvation as long as you live. That is why you need to work on your salvation as long as you live. It is not what? A one-day thing. It is not a one-day job. So we don't take salvation for granted. I have been born again. I speak in tongues. I have been baptized. Therefore, I am bound for heaven. Yes, that forms part of your word, of your salvation. But that is not the end of it. The bigger part of the job depends on after you are surrendered to the Lord. It depends on afterward you have lifted up your hands and surrendered your life to God. That is when the enemy begins to bring the challenges. That is when the enemy begins to challenge you with your past life. That is when the enemy begins to convince you of certain characters that you used to have.
That is when the enemy begins to tell you, ask for this character, it is good for you. Keep it, don't leave it. Because that is what is going to lead you into your success. That is when the enemy will begin to tell you a whole lot of things. And that is when, as a child of God, you must remain sensitive to the spirit that has been given unto you. Because it is that spirit, it is through that spirit that your God will direct every step that you take. That is why the Bible says, as children of God, we must be vigilant as the serpent. We must be very vigilant as the serpent, as so that we, the enemy, would not steal us. So that the enemy would not deceive us. We don't have to allow the enemy to take control over our lives and begin to dictate the pace, deceiving us and making us know that everything is all right with us. I want us to look at something from the book of Romans chapter 6, the verse 1, just to clarify on what I have been saying. Romans chapter 6, the verse 1. Romans chapter 6, the verse 1. Go. He said, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? How shall we who died to sin live any longer to it? How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? You have died to sin. When you were baptized, or when you accepted the Lord as your God and personal Savior, you said to Him, I have accepted you as my Lord and my personal Savior. Now come and dwell in me. You died to sin. You died to sin. That confession you made meant that you are going to dedicate your whole life to God. You are going to serve Him all the days of your life. That confession you made was what? Telling God, that, Father, I am no more going back to the past. Everything that I did now belongs to the past. Father, I accept you. I embrace you as my Lord and personal Savior. Therefore, every step that I take from today shall be directed and controlled by you. He said, should we continue to sin? Should we continue to sin? We who have what? We who have died to sin. Should we continue to sin? Should we go ahead and continue to sin? If we have said that we have been crucified, we are dead to sin. Should we continue to sin? The Bible says no. Or do you not know that as many as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into His death? Therefore, we were buried with Him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also shall walk in newness of life. We also shall walk in newness of life. Just as Christ died and was resurrected in the glory of God, that in the same way we as children of God will walk in a new life. The old must die. The old must die. People who knew you before, when they see you today, they must see a new person. People who knew you before, when they see you today, they must not see any traces of the past in you, because you have been dead to the past. You have been dead to that sin as a child of God. That is why it is very important as children of God to evaluate ourselves every time, so that we may assess ourselves and know whether what we are walking in the things of God, or we are still in the past, or we are still exhibiting some characteristics of the past. He said we are dead to sin. As Christ was baptized, or as Christ was buried and arose in the glory of God, we have been buried in our sin, and we are awake again in a new life. A new life. The old is gone. The past is gone. It is no more. There should be no traces of the past in your life as a child of God. That is why the Bible is again so that we should work on our salvation with fear and trembling. From the day that you accepted the Lord as your God and personal Savior, you need to be working on that salvation every time. You need to be working on that salvation, what? Every time. Therefore, as a child of God, you must always be sensitive to the Spirit. Always assessing the decisions that you make, assessing the conclusions that you draw, and seeing that they are in conformity with the Word of God. He said, you are no more. You no more belong to the past. For if you have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. He said, knowing that our old man be crucified with the Lord. Therefore, Lord, the day that you accepted God, the day you were baptized, you died, your old man died. So the question you need to be asking yourself today is, my old man really dead? Am I really dead to the past? Are there no traces of my past life within me now? Can people see me and say, yes, of the truth, I am a new creation? Can people see me and say, yes, you are a new person? Can people see you and begin to say that? That is the question we need to be asking ourselves as children of God. That is the salvation, or that is the new birth that Jesus was talking about to Nicodemus in the book of John. He said, when you are crucified with the Lord, you have crucified the old man with the Lord. And when you accept him as your God, you arise also from that baptism as a new person. Therefore, you must live a life that is what? That is right before the Lord. For he who died is what? For he who has died has been freed from sin. From he who has died has been freed from sin. You have been freed from sin. How have you been freed from sin? The Spirit of God has come to dwell within you. It speaks to you. It directs you. It prompts you. Anytime you are doing anything that is wrong before the Lord, the Holy Spirit within you prompts you. Therefore, for you to be able to live that new life, you must be sensitive to that Spirit within you. You must be obedient to that Spirit that dwells within you. Look, there is something very dangerous in the Bible. It said, not all those who say, Lord, Lord, shall inherit the kingdom of God. It is not all of us who find ourselves in church every day will be in the kingdom of God. But those who have lived their life as God expected them to live their lives. Those who are able to crucify or to kill that old man and take on a new person and walk as a child of God, those are the people who will inherit the kingdom of God. That is why the Bible says when you accept the Lord as your God and personal Savior, you are no more indebted to this flesh. You are indebted to the Spirit that dwells within you. So what you should seek to please as a child of God is the Spirit of God that dwells within you. Therefore, you need to always be attentive to that Spirit and act according to His will and purposes. Children of God, it's about time we wake up. It is about time we begin to live a life that is holy and acceptable unto the Lord. Because when He talks about when He talks about salvation, that is all it is about. The kingdom of God is about how you finish your journey as a child of God. Salvation, or the kingdom, the salvation is about how you finish your journey as a child of God. Look, if salvation were to be only for you to lift up your hands and accept the Lord as your Lord and personal Savior, if that were to be the only thing, the enemy would have no job to do. Because the moment you lifted up your hands, you are bound for heaven. But the reason why the enemy is seriously at work now is that you have to be able to defend that salvation to the end. That is why the Lord has stressed it categorically. We should work on it with fear and trembling. With fear and trembling. Because you might lose it if you allow the enemy to take charge of your life. With fear and trembling. With fear and trembling. Because there is a probability that you can lose that salvation along the line if you don't stand for Christ. If you don't stand for who you are. If you don't stand for who you believe in. You might end up losing that salvation. That's why he said you should fight for it with fear and trembling. The enemy is seriously at work, working to get people into his kingdom. The Bible says his only work that he does is to kill, to steal, and to destroy. Steal your salvation from you. Steal your salvation from you. Destroy your joy that the Lord has in store for you. My brother, my sister, if you would sit up and begin to assess your life and begin to crucify certain old things that is in your life and take on the Spirit of God in you, you will begin to enjoy the peace of God in you. You will begin to enjoy the peace of God in you. If we should know, that's why the songwriter said, what things we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry it to God in prayer. All because we don't know who we are. All because we don't know what we carry. All because we allow the enemy to take control over certain areas of our lives. We don't enjoy the privileges as children of God. If you want to experience God, if you want to experience God in your life, if you want your journey with the Lord to become fruitful, if in the end you want to achieve heaven, if in the end you want to achieve the kingdom, my brother, my sister, seek to crucify that old man within you. Seek to crucify that old man within you. That behavior, that character in the past will never help you. There is no way that it can help you. Look, the only thing that can be fulfilled in your life as a child of God is the purposes of God concerning your life. Nothing good can happen to you as a human being than what the Lord has planned for your life. Nothing good can happen to you again as a human being than what the Lord has purposed for your life. He made you. He created you. He knows that which is good for your life. Therefore, anything contrary to his will and purposes for your life will never be good for you. Someone may challenge, yes, I am not serving God. Yes, I am not doing it, but I am living a life that I think is good.
But there is one thing I want you to know, that whatever you think is good is just temporary. In the end, after you have finished this life, what will be or where would you be? That is what we need to be considering now. My brother, my sister, that old life would never help you. That old life would never leave you anywhere. It may seem that, yes, that is what is sustaining me now. Pastor, if I should leave this life, how am I going to survive? If I should leave this attitude behind, how am I going to survive? Or if I should stop this habit, how am I going to survive? But I am telling you that the God that we serve knows better. The God that we serve knows better. He knows how to deal with you. He knows how to handle the situation. All he wants from you is to come to him and say, Father, I surrender this life. I will no more continue the way I am going. I want to live a life that is acceptable unto you. I want to sacrifice my whole life and live all my life for you and you alone. That is what God is seeking after. That is what God wants from you. A total surrender. A total surrender. Not a partial one. God wants a total surrender of your life. I don't know what your challenges are. I don't know what your challenges are. But one thing I know is that when you bring it to God, he knows or he has a solution for every challenge in your life. You cannot battle the battle. You cannot fight that fight unless you surrender it to God. That is why the Bible says it is not by power, it is not by might, but by the Spirit of the living God. Someone listening may say, Pastor, I have been trying to get rid of this old life. This very character is disturbing me. I have been trying to deal with it for ages and I can't. What I am telling you tonight is to surrender it to God. Total surrender to God, because you cannot do it by your power. You cannot do it by your power until you surrender it to God. Until you leave it all to God and say, Father, I give it all to you. Have your way in my life. Let your will be done. Let your purpose prevail in my life. That is what God requires of you. And he will take over. He will take over your life and have his way in your life. God wants you to kill that old man. He wants that old man within you to die. He wants that old character to die. He wants that old attitude to die. He wants his new character alone to rule in your life. He wants his spirit alone to rule in your life. He wants you to be obedient to only his voice and his voice alone. I want us to read something from the book of Galatians, chapter 6, the verse 12. Galatians chapter 6. The verse 12. Galatians chapter 6. The verse 12. It says,
as many as desire to make a good showing in the flesh, this would compel you to be circumcised, only that they may not suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. For not even those who are circumcised keep the law, but they desire to have you circumcised, that you may boast in your flesh. But God forbid that I should boast except in the cross. Except what? In the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world has been what? Crucified. He said, I will boast in what? In the cross of my Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world has been what? Crucified. Has been crucified to me, and by whom the world has been crucified to me, and I to the world. By whom the world has been crucified to me, and I to the world. This is Paul who was speaking. By whom the world, I will boast in only Jesus Christ. By whom what? The world has been crucified. And what? The world has been crucified, and I to the world. I have been crucified to the world through Christ Jesus. My desire is no more in things of the world, because I have been crucified to the world. I don't desire for things of the world anymore. I desire for things of heaven, because I have been crucified to this world. I don't belong to this world anymore. I belong to the kingdom of God. Look, the Bible says we should seek first the kingdom of God and His what? Righteousness, and all these things, all the things that we desire for, what shall be added unto us, because the God that we serve knows that we need those things. It is He who made you. It is He who created you. He knows what you need even more than yourself. God knows what you need even more than yourself. And all He requires of you as a child of God is to crucify yourself to this world and desires of the things of the flesh, of the spirit alone. Desire things of the spirit. Crucify yourself to this world. If you have crucified yourself to this world, you will be at peace anytime, because things of this world will no more matter to you. Things of this world will no more matter to you. Because what? You believe in the God that you serve. You believe in the God whom you surrendered your life to. And you know that every minute, every hour, every second, He will be in charge of your life. He will be directing every step that you take. He will be controlling your destiny. He will be controlling your future. Therefore, things of this world will mean nothing to you, because you have a supernatural power in charge of your life. You have a supernatural authority ruling over your life. Until you crucify this flesh, until you begin to crucify this flesh, begin to crucify your mind, and begin to take on the Spirit of God, my brother, my sister, you will never realize who you are as a child of God. Because the world will always present its challenges. The world will always present its challenges. But if you refuse to see those challenges that the world presents you, and see that what the Lord has for you, my brother, my sister, you would always be at peace, irrespective of the trials and tribulations, because you know that you serve a God of impossibility. Because you know that you serve a God who makes a way where there is no way. You serve a God who calls that which is not as if it is. That is the God that you serve. Crucify the flesh. Don't allow the flesh to speak to you. Don't allow the flesh to speak to you. Don't allow the flesh to make decisions for you. Don't allow the flesh to draw conclusions for you. Allow the Spirit to take charge of your life. That decisions will be under the control of the Spirit of God. Conclusions will be under the control of the Spirit of God. That is when a child of God is able to walk by faith. That is when a child of God is able to walk by faith. Because our God that we serve does not look at the present. Our God that we serve looks into the future. The Spirit that dwells within you always looks into the future. The Spirit that dwells within us always look, it doesn't look at the present. Joseph was bound to be blessed. Joseph was bound to be blessed. If you were to look at the present, if you were to look at the present and acted according to the present, he wouldn't have been able to get into his blessings. If he had looked, I am in a palace. I have everything that I want. I have everything under my control. Now, if I should sleep even with my master's wife, I will gain more control over my master, because my master's wife can be able to convince him to do more things for me because I have had a relationship with her. Joseph did not see that. He allowed the Spirit of God to take control over his life. He allowed what? The Holy Spirit, or the Spirit of God, to take control over his life. Therefore, he did not see what he needed to enjoy presently. He saw the future. What will be my end in the eyes of God if I should sleep with this woman? By listening to that Spirit that dwells within him, by acting according to the Spirit and not according to the flesh, he was able to walk into his future. Until you kill that old man, until you crucify that old man in your life, the purposes of God concerning your life can never be fulfilled. The desires of God of concerning your life can never be fulfilled. There are certain things that we classify as, you know, oh, as for this, it is not any big sin. This is just a small sin. That small sin can prevent you from getting into your destiny. That small sin can prevent you from walking into your breakthrough. That small thing can prevent you from walking into your testimony. There is one thing you need to know. The enemy will use any little thing to steal from you. That is why you need to totally surrender your life to God so that the will and purposes of God can be fulfilled in your life. So that there will be no barrier between you and your God. So there will be no barrier between you and your breakthrough. So that there will be no barrier between you and your success. So that there will be no barrier between you and your testimony. Kill that old man. Kill that old man. Don't let the attitude prevent you from walking into your destiny. Don't let that character prevent you from walking into your destiny. Don't let the present deceive you from walking into the good things that the Lord has for your life. Don't let the enemy deceive you. Don't let the enemy deceive you. Your God that you serve, your God Jesus Christ, or your Lord Jesus, whom you have accepted as your God and as your Lord and personal Savior, requires you to totally surrender your life to him. Requires you to totally crucify this flesh. Requires you to totally kill and destroy that old man and take on a new self. That is why he said, unless you are born again. Unless you are born again. That which is born of the flesh is of the flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is of the Spirit. Therefore, if you are born of the Spirit, you must live according to the Spirit. The day you lifted up your hands was the day you crucified flesh. The day you lifted up your hands was the day you were born in the spirit. Therefore, my brother, my sister, we need to continue to live in the spirit. We need to continue to live in the spirit. I want us to read something from the book of Titus, chapter 1. Titus chapter 3, the verse 1 to 8. Titus chapter 3, the verse 1 to 8. Titus chapter 3, verse 1 to 8. The Bible says, remind them to be subject to rulers and authorities, to obey, to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of no one, to be peaceable, gentle, showing all humility to all men. For we ourselves were also once foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving various lusts and pleasures, living in a malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. But when the kindness of the love of God, our Savior, toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. Through the washing of what? Through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, that having been justified by his grace, we have become heirs according to the hope of what? Of eternal life. This is a faithful saying that these things I want you to affirm constantly, that those who have believed in God should be careful. Listen, he said, for those who have believed in God should be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable to men. He said, what? For those who have believed in God should maintain good works. Should what? Maintain good works. Salvation is not a one-off thing. He said, you should what? Maintain what? Goodness. Whatever you surrender, I mean, the day you surrendered yourself and whatever you surrendered that day should remain in the past. He said, well, you should what? You should maintain good works. I want you to begin to go into your life. Begin to assess yourself from the time you accepted Christ till today. What are the things that have gone missing in your life? What are the things that have gone missing in your life? What are the things that you have found coming back into your life from the past? What attitude have you gone back to? What characters have you gone back to? And begin to deal with yourself. And begin to deal with yourself. What are the things that you used to do as a child of God that you do no more? What are the things that you used not to do as a child of God that you are now doing? There should be some pluses and some minuses in your life. Take out the old and bring in the new. Take out the old and bring in the new, so that the glory of God can be seen in your life. So that what? The glory of God can be seen in your life. The Bible says we are the light of the world. We are the light of the world. The question I want you to be asking yourself tonight, is my light shining? Is my light shining? Is my light shining? Am I being a light to the world? Am I being a light to the world? Or people are looking at me and saying to themselves, because of me, they won't serve God anymore. Am I being a light? Are people seeing me and say, look, because of my character, they are going to serve God? Begin to assess yourself. Begin to ask yourself, am I really living a life that is holy and acceptable to God? Am I in the right books of God? Should God come today, will he see me as a new man? Should God come today, will he see some traces of the past in me? The Bible says, if you be cold, be cold. If you be hot, be hot. If you are lukewarm, he will spit you out of his mouth. He doesn't want people who are lukewarm. Therefore, we need to start and make a decision whether we are following God or we are not. You need to stand up and begin to make decisions. We need to make what positive decisions that when Christ should come today, we will be able to go with him. When Christ should come today, we'll be able to ascend into the heavens with him. My brother, we must start assessing our lives. We must start assessing our lives. We don't just have to live our lives anyhow. We don't just have to carry that title, a Christian, on our lives for nothing. We must reflect Christ. If you call yourself Christian, you must reflect Christ. You must reflect Christ. You must represent a new person. You must be a new person. You must be a new person. The Lord is watching us. The Lord is watching us. Each and every day in our walk as a child of God. Each and every day in our walk as a child of God. We are what? We are building. We are building up what? Our responses that we are going to give to our God. We are building up responses that we are going to give up to God. God is watching us. God is watching us. Every step that we take, every move that we make is being recorded. What is being recorded for you as a child of God? What is being recorded in the heavens to you? What are the things that will be read to you on that day? Will you stand smiling or you will stand weeping? I want you to go into your life. I want you to go into your life and begin to ask yourself these questions. That should God come today? Should God call me today? Would I be able to stand straight before my God? Should God call me today? Would I be able to stand straight before God? We don't know when he is going to call us. We don't know when the Lord will be calling us. He can call us anytime. He can call us anytime. But should he call you, what do you have to say? Should he call you, what do you have to tell him? It is never too late. It is never too late. Anytime that you open up your heart to God, anytime you surrender to God, he is ready to receive you. I don't know who is listening to me tonight. But if you have not accepted the Lord as your God and personal Savior, the time is now. The time is now. Because he is coming and he is coming very soon. He is coming and he is coming very soon. It doesn't matter how sinful you are. The Bible says his hands are wide open. He is ready to embrace you and wash you and clean you and make you as white as snow. His hands. He said he is standing at the door. Look, there is one thing I want you to know. That as you even continue to sin, the Lord continues to stand at the door and he keeps knocking. He keeps knocking. He never rejects you. The Lord will never reject you. Every time he is at the door knocking. So don't let the enemy deceive you that you are so sinful that God will never forgive you. He is always at the door knocking. He is always at the door knocking. Look, the reason why he came to die is what he is because of sinners. He came to die because of sinners. The reason why he was crucified on the cross is what because of sinners. So his hands are wide open, ready to receive you. Ready to receive you. It doesn't matter. The Lord is ready to receive you. As his child, the Lord is ready to receive you. As it doesn't matter how deep the enemy has taken you, your God is ready to bring you out. It doesn't matter how far the enemy has pushed you, your God is ready to bring you out. You might be thinking that as far as the enemy has taken me, the enemy has taken me so far that there is no way I can come out. I have sinned so much that there is no way God can forgive me. I am telling you tonight, no sin is big to God. Or there is no sin that God can never forgive. There is no sin that God can never forgive. God is ready to forgive every sin, no matter how big it is. God is ready to forgive you. All he wants from you, my brother, my sister, is to surrender yourself to him. All he wants from you, my brother, is to surrender yourself to him and take him as your Lord and personal Savior. All he wants for you to say to him, Father, tonight I surrender my life into your hands. I dedicate my whole life into your hands. Have your way and let your will be done in me. I crucify this flesh and I want your spirit to fill my life. And you allow his spirit to fill your life. And you, your life would never be the same. Your life would never be the same. If you are listening to me and you have received the Lord as your God and personal Savior, and because of certain things you are backslided, or because of certain things you are not able to serve God correctly, I am telling you tonight that he is ready to take you back. He said he will lift us in our fall. He will strengthen us in our weakness. It doesn't matter your weakness. Your God is ready to strengthen you. It doesn't matter how you are falling. Your God is ready to lift you up. All he wants from you is for you to surrender your will unto him. I believe tonight your life will never be the same. I believe after tonight your life is never going to be the same. I want you to go to bed reflecting on this word. I want you to reflect on this word. I want you to reflect on this word. And make a decision in your walk with the Lord. And make a decision in your walk with the Lord. Let the spirit that dwells within you begin to speak to you. That the old will be crucified. That the spirit of God will take absolute control over your life. I believe tonight you have been blessed. I believe tonight the Lord has spoken into your spirit. And your life would never be the same. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Father, we thank you for your word tonight. Master, I magnify and I praise your name tonight for your word. Father, I commit my brothers and sisters who want to receive you as their Lord and personal Savior tonight into your hands. That Father, you will touch them tonight. That Father, you will visit them tonight. That Father, you will forgive them of every iniquity tonight. That you will draw them closer unto yourself, even as your word says. That you will wash them from the crowns of their heads to the soles of their feet. That they shall become as white as snow. It is my prayer that their lives will never remain the same. Father, those who are fallen, I pray that, Lord, you will lift them up. Father, those who are weak, I pray that you will strengthen. That, Lord Jesus, we will be able to live a life that is holy and acceptable unto you. That, Father, in the end, Daddy, when you come, we will all be able to ascend unto you and sing praise and honor unto your name. Have your way in us. Let your mighty hands be lifted up upon our lives. Take our hands.